Because I think that's the other thing, going back to just this idea of how we're, our mental health is so bad as millennials. When we are stressed, when we are anxious, when we are burnt out, depressed, the first things to go in our life are the things that make us the happiest.
Are you going through life blind? This is Eyes Wide Open with Nick Thompson. On this podcast, we share knowledge and stories that build human connection while elevating stigmatized societal issues such as mental health, holistic wellness, culture, free speech, and more. All to ensure we show up in the world with our eyes wide open. Hello, everyone. My guest today is Jessica Rabon. She's a licensed clinical psychologist who specializes in pediatric psychology and has clinical interests in anxiety, depression, the LGBTQ plus health community, for community health, and more. She's also published several peer-reviewed articles on topics including depression, gratitude, and suicide. So Dr. Jessica is the host of two podcasts, her own podcast called Psych Talk, and a co-host of the podcast Welcome to Group Therapy, which I am a pretty regular listener to. And recently, you also spoke, which we'll talk a little bit about, at the Millennials Coping with Anxiety, I don't know, conference, festival, summit. Whatever. Summit. And we'll talk specifically about that and anxiety with social media and millennials and probably a little bit of Gen Z too. So thank you for coming to the show today. How are you?
I'm great. Thank you for having me, Nick. I'm so excited to be here with you and talk as we were chatting for like 30 minutes before we hit record. You've been on both my solo podcast, the group podcast, so it's nice to be on yours and also catch up because we haven't talked face-to-face other than via social media in a while. So
in a while, yeah. And I would, that was like last summer, I think I was on, I think we said that earlier. Last summer, I was on both of those. They were both great experiences. Everyone's wonderful. So I'm glad that we can return the favor and learn a little bit about you and your expertise instead of my reality TV adventures and everything that's come since.
Absolutely.
So my favorite question I have to start with, and that is, what did you want to be when you were growing up? And how did that change over time to where you are now?
So I know you know the answer to this, so I'm going to kind of throw you off and go prior to the answer you know and then add.
Okay.
So really, when I was really young, I don't remember exactly what I wanted to be, but like late elementary, early middle school, I wanted to be an interior designer, which is interesting because I'm not really artistic at all. I just liked home makeover shows. And then around late middle school, it was like I was 12, 13 years old, I took chemistry and decided I wanted to be a chemist of some sort. As I got through high school, decided I wanted to be a pharmacist. So I went to
those
college.
Two kind of go together, a little separate from the interior design, but
absolutely. Probably because I realized I don't actually have an artistic eye, and I like to watch shows, but I still like to watch them, but I look and I'm like, yeah, I cannot visualize anything that you all are doing in that show. Then I thought I was going to be a pharmacist. So I went to graduate school or went to undergrad to study chemistry, was a chemistry major for my first 2 years. I'm obviously not a chemist. I'm a clinical psychologist. So to backtrack a little bit, the first semester of my freshman year of college, my cousin died by suicide. And so I obviously was very much impacted by that. I started working for volunteering for a nonprofit, Mental Health America, eventually got a job with them, worked on the crisis line. So I was doing a lot of mental health related stuff. At the same time, was like, still going to go to pharmacy school. And then I took a intro to psychology course my second semester sophomore year because I had to as like a gen ed requirement. And I loved it. I was like, this is what it feels like to get excited about going to class. Like I was in like bioorganic chemistry at the time. So it's not like I was early into my chem degree at all. And I was like, this is what it feels like to like get up and be, I remember it was an 8 a.m. class. And back then I was not a morning person. And so I talked to my professor and was just like, hey, I'm thinking about switching my major to psychology. Is that feasible since I'm second semester sophomore, spoke with my parents, spoke with my advisor in chemistry, was like, yeah, this is not working out. And
were they supportive?
So my professor with chemistry was, cause he could tell, like, once I got to bioorganic, I was struggling. Yeah. And I did, and part of it was, I just like didn't enjoy it anymore. But I also, at that point, that had been my career trajectory since I was like in seventh or eighth grade. So I didn't really know what else to do. My parents took a little more convincing, at least from my recollection. They probably are like, no,
they might remember it different.
But I think it was also because I was just like, I think they were more like, okay, what are you going to do with the degree? Because reality, you can't do much with an undergrad in psychology.
No, what can you do? I know a lot of people go into like marketing.
I was about to, so advertising and marketing, you can. You can get jobs in like mental health facilities as more like a behavioral tech type person. And I guess I need to clarify, I'm speaking for the United States. I can't speak to other countries. But yeah, there's not much you can do. You can be a psychometrist. So I don't know if you know what that is. So that's
I've actually never heard of that.
So psychologists are taught how to do psychological assessment. A psychometrist is someone that has an undergraduate degree in psychology, sometimes a master's, and they're also trained to do the assessments like under the supervision of a psychologist. So they'll administer like the intelligence tests or personality tests to like lessen the burden off the psychologist.
It's kind of like a dental hygienist, like doing a lot of the hard work, but not necessarily the not necessarily like the heavy lifting of the results of it.
No, exactly. No, that's a great comparison. So yeah, there's not much you can do. I didn't really know what I wanted to do. I was like, do I do health psychology, clinical psychology? I had been working on the crisis line. So I ended up applying to master's programs because I really didn't know what I wanted to do. Got in master's in clinical psychology, got more experience there, applied to PhD programs, got in there. And now I've been, oh gosh, coming up on 6 years independently licensed, which is weird to say.
Now, independently licensed means... Well, we're going to get into what's a millennial in a little bit. So.
So for when you get a doctorate in clinical psychology, so grad school, depending on the specific program, things like that. But in clinical psychology, PsyD, anywhere from 4 to 6 years, PhD, 5 to 7. So you go through all that schooling. The last year's a year-long clinical internship. So I always tell people it's like a one-year medical residency. Because we go through the same process. You have to apply to places, you interview, you match, you have to move. And then after that, so then you're a doctor, but most states require you to do a postdoctoral fellowship. So even though you have your doctorate, you're not licensed. So you have to do a whole nother year or two depending on the state.
And that's state by state, right?
And then you sit for your national licensing exam, your state licensing exam. And then, yeah, so I had to do, let's say I did 4 years undergrad, 6 years grad school, 1 year postdoc. So 11 years before I was able to get licensed. And then you're licensed one day and you no longer have Like I still have a supervisor, but not like you, it's not needed. And you're like, what do I do now?
Is it like a mentor then or what do they?
Yeah. So,
okay.
I mean, some people still do formal supervision just with, I work in a hospital. And so my, the head of our department just offers clinical supervision to everybody. We just once monthly check in, obviously more frequently if I need it, but we just have a standing hour supervision monthly just to talk about what's going on. Yeah.
That's good. That's a lot of school. Holy cow. I don't know. You thinking of going back for something else or?
No, I did. I've talked about this a lot. Like, honestly, one of the, I mean, I've been through a lot of hard things, but one of the hardest things in my adult life was finishing graduate school and going.
Okay.
So before my, I started my postdoctoral fellowship, I had about 6 weeks between finishing internship And that 6 weeks, I was like, who am I? Like, I have no idea who I am. Because I had been in school literally my entire life.
Your whole life.
And I was like, I don't know who I am. So we had, and we moved states. We moved back to where I was doing fellowship, but back to where my husband's from. And I was like, I need to find a therapist because I don't know what's going on with my life right now. And this transition, it's just hard because I was a student for, I got my PhD at 28, barely. I got it a few weeks before I turned 29. But
pretty impressive though.
But at 28, so from what, five, if you're not counting preschool, to 28, I was in school.
That's crazy. That's actually one of the reasons I like to ask this question, because I feel like a lot of times, I mean, my whole theory of the case came because I asked a few people random questions early on in my podcast, and everyone had these like extravagant dreams when they were a kid. And then like oftentimes would go to school for something they, you know, stumbled upon, but then realized at some point, like, I actually don't want to do this. And I feel like when you're in school for till you're 22, till 18, 22, 20, 5, 6, and then 28, right? Like, you're in the grind. A lot of times you're working or you're just school full time, right? Like, you don't have time to process, to think, and then you don't have the experience. And I think the experience is so underrated. And I'm not talking like, I'm talking real life experience.
Yeah.
Like, you could love being in school for psychology and then get out to practice it and realize, oh, this actually isn't appealing. And I like it in theory, but you know, so you just, and you kind of maybe went through that a little bit earlier on, but that's why I think so interesting about this question. Cause I feel like a lot of the times people just kind of get stuck with the current and they don't have an opportunity to like step aside and see if they want that. But it turned out you did.
I did. But I mean, on a smaller scale, I feel like exactly what you said, that's kind of how I felt with chemistry. Cause I like for so long was in it and I was like, I don't know what else I would do. So let me stick into it. But exactly like you said, I hear people say that all the time. They went to school for something because they thought it's what they liked. And then they actually went into the real world and were like, I don't know if this is what I want to do. Or they choose a career based off of family pressure or, oh, well, everybody in my family is a doctor or nurse, so I'll just go into the medical field. But maybe you're really creative and like arts and stuff.
Well, unfortunately, the world isn't made much for the creative types. There's not a lot of, unless you're like super niche or, you know, catch a real life algorithm where something your art takes off. It's really hard to get into the space. And I grew up wanting to be a filmmaker in my teens. And I went to my orientation at film school here in Chicago and I was like, I want to do this. I don't want to do this here. Like, I don't want some school to tell me how to make movies. So I just went and like did it myself. So I think and quickly found out it's a very expensive hobby and not that easy to break into.
Yep. But that's that real life experience you were just talking about.
Yeah.
Real world. You learn.
But exactly. And then I was able to kind of pull out the like, what do I like about it? Well, I like the storytelling element. I like letting people, or having stories to tell, giving people an opportunity to tell that story. So it's kind of like, that's how I got into marketing, but it's weird. It's just it's a weird thing to be making such big decisions when your brain hasn't even fully developed, but you're so young and you don't know anything.
Oh, I know. I talk about that all the time. Cause as you said, I work in pediatrics. So I work primarily with Gen Z and Gen Alpha, which is so weird to say, but
What's Gen Alpha? Is that
younger than Gen Z? So like 2010 to 12, depending on where you're looking and on. So like the little kids.
Oh my God. I haven't heard that.
But most of my clientele is Gen Z. And so, you know, we work on life transitions going into adulthood. And so many of them are like, my parents went to college. I want to go to college, but I have no idea what I want to do. And I tell them all the time, like, you don't have to know what to do. And they're like, but everybody in my life says I do. And I'm like, but you don't.
And they didn't
know either. I promise you. Like, the fact that, I mean, I don't know when exactly your birthday is, but I'm a young, like, I'm late August. So I graduated high school at 17.
Wow.
What 17-year-old needs to be making?
No.
decision. You but don't. Even 18, 19, I mean, you even 25-year-olds don't even always know what they want to do. Even 50-year-olds don't know what they want to do. So, yeah. So if you're listening to this in Gen Z, no pressure.
No pressure. Don't let other people pressure you. And that's the thing too. Like I grew up being told I didn't have to go to college, like working class, blue collar. My dad's an electrician. My mom worked at a grocery store, like all of these things. So I grew up with that, and I like had to fight that because I did want to go to college and I did want to do, you know, something where that was filmmaking or writing or something creative. And I think what happens is one way or another, there's all this pressure. So mine was not to go to college. Don't waste the money. It's not worth the money. Yep. You can get a job, like all of that stuff. And then I think now it's probably maybe shifted a little bit to be that you have to go to college. And well, maybe you don't. I mean, there's people that make 6-7 figures online with side hustles or, you know, pushing product through social media, influencing and all of that stuff. There's so many things that, you know, if you find your craft and you're passionate about it, like you, for the most part, I think there's ways to make money now because of the internet.
Mm-hmm. Oh, absolutely. And going to what you just said, not only pressure to go to college, but like then graduate school. Because honestly, like, I mean, I know college I talk about psychology, but like, there's not much you can do with an undergrad in psychology, for example. And so now it's like, oh, you need a master's or a doctorate. And there's so much privilege in even getting a college degree. And then we could talk about student loan debt. This is we're talking about all the reasons we're anxious without even saying it. But
we're actually talking about our own traumas as millennials right here.
No
pressure we went through.
It is so true. Like, you know, it is when you were talking about, oh, it's a waste of money and things like that. Honestly, with how expensive college is these days, it is. It's not affordable by any means. And then you're risking student loan debt. I mean, I know a lot of people, like one of my cousin's kids actually is going to college next year. He dual enrolled in high school. So he already has 1 year under his belt. He's going to go to community college for another year. And then transfer because he's like, I mean, and he's brilliant, but he was like, why would I waste money going to a 4-year
That's college? What I did too.
And I think that's so smart, but a lot of people don't. I think that's becoming more common, but I feel like a lot of people don't think of it that way. You're still getting the same core classes out of the way.
Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. I just don't think people know. And I think it's kind of like this, I don't want to say it's a marketing scheme, but it might be, where it's like the whole 4-year university, live on campus. Mm-hmm. This is a lifestyle. This is your part of your growth into adulthood. And there's just like this expectation that is put on you, and that is put above of. And listen, I was given loans. I should have never given it 18, 19, 20, 21. Never knew what I was signing up for, right? Like, oh, I'll absolutely be in student debt probably the rest of my life. And it's just, it's crazy because you're sold the dream. And what it really is that if it can be, I should say, what it can be is an anchor to keep you in this, you know, massive amount of debt. And that keeps you in a constant state of anxiety about your finances, and you've always got to make more, and you've always got to work more, and you've always got to, you know, advance your career, whether you like it or not, because that's the only way to get ahead and the way that maybe you'll pay this debt off. And by the way, good luck if you want to buy a house. And it's just crazy. And I think, you know, it's funny because I initially asked you if you wanted to come on. Which I had been meaning to. I just get kind of like, so many people come to me sometimes. I'm just like, oh, I got to remember to ask people that I actually want to talk to on, you know, my own too. But you were in the speaking at the summit, or was it a workshop? Was it speaking or a workshop?
So it was like video.
Oh, okay, cool.
Recording. So it was a summit, but like we videoed in. It wasn't a physical location.
Cool. So it's an organization called Millennials Coping with Anxiety, right?
Anxiety. Yeah. That was the summit. Yeah.
And then your topic was anxiety and social media. And
yes,
I would love to talk about that, but I feel, you know, we talked a little bit about this before it came in, like millennials and Gen Z are having excessive and continuous mental health challenges. Mm-hmm. And I think first, this is probably a good segue. I'm trying to be fair and devil's advocate here.
Okay.
I do think that it's not just millennials and Gen Z.
Oh, absolutely.
I think that there's less of a stigma around mm-hmm. millennials and even less of a stigma around Gen Z, which is good, right? So it may be like more people are self-reporting their mm-hmm. mental health challenges, their anxieties, their depressions, you know, their whatever it might be. And so therefore getting diagnosed more often. Mm-hmm. So devil's advocate there. I think there's something to be said there, but it's like record amount yep. of people in this country specifically, but really it is globally, that are having these challenges and these anxieties. What's your overall view on what's causing this? And I'll just sit back and shut my mic off.
I was about to say, this is a loaded question. So I'm going to start with, I completely agree with everything you just said. All of us are being impacted, regardless of generation, of worsening mental health. Mm-hmm. I also agree millennials and Gen Z are more likely to talk about it, or even if they don't have access to seek a formal diagnosis, there's so much information out there. They can be like, okay, yeah, this is anxiety or this is depression, mm-hmm. things like that. So I don't know if I could do it overall, but some of the main things, a lot of what we already talked about, just like finances, debt, mm-hmm. those kind of things. Like, so there's a really good book by Dr. Lauren Cook. She's a psychologist, called Generation Anxiety. And it's all about this, like millennial and Gen Z anxiety. And in it, she talks about, or one of the things that she brings up is how like millennials are the first generation not to exceed their parents' income, job status. So exactly what we were talking about. We're burdened with debt. I mean, I don't know about, well, you said you're blue collar. Both my parents went to college. They had no student loan debt. Their college cost
used to be like $4,000.
Yeah, I was about to say it was like a couple hundred bucks a semester. So what they did in 4 years didn't even touch one semester of when I was in college. And like looking at college's cost now, even just in the past 10 to 15 years, exorbitant. Like, so we have that stress, exactly what you alluded to, like always having to do more, that whole hustle culture. Like, we're not working only 40 hours a week anymore. Like, I don't know anybody, even, you know, entrepreneurs, like you were saying, you can make a living off of social media, but it's not like they're only working 40 hours. Like, you know, what you might see is a couple minutes of a video, but you don't know all the stuff going on in the background.
Well, I can tell you, so here's the thing. I can tell you, like, content creation isn't easy.
No.
From so many, it takes me 30 to 45 minutes to post a already clipped clip of my podcast, mm-hmm. copy and slightly edit pieces of the description for the caption, put subtitles on it, make sure that I have the link so that I can link to it, mm-hmm. post the reel, post it in my story. Then go to TikTok, do the same thing. Then go to LinkedIn, do the same thing. And I don't have the same message about the content for each one. So they're all a little bit tweaked. And this, it takes me just to post something and rewrite it a little bit, almost an hour across platforms.
Oh, absolutely.
And that's already edited. They already found the clip. You know what I mean? So it's like, I can tell you, and I'm not even... I don't get crazy with the stuff that I produce. I usually just throw my camera up somewhere and say what's on my mind. And then boom, I got a reel or a story or a post or whatever. But the other thing that comes with that is people have to think. Like, we live in a culture right now where like your output is what you're judged on and not the thought that goes into it. And I think that's something I know really stresses me out. Even today with work, I was like reading a newsletter based on my industry, based on research, and this is very helpful for me to do but I felt guilty because I'm sitting there for, you know, a half an hour reading this newsletter, even though it's going to empower the decisions I make because I'm not actually outputting anything. Mm-hmm. And I know that it's not just me that feels that way because I have people I know that are the same way.
Oh, I mean, relating that back to my field, like there's some day I work in a hospital. So on the days I don't have like scheduled patients, you know, I'm doing consults in the hospital, rounding and things like that. But those are also usually the days I have time to catch up on emails, like scheduling all these things. And there's some days I look back and I'm like, I was not productive at all because I only saw three patients. And then I have to be like, no, you also did 5 extra hours of all this other stuff that you don't, it's not shown for because I'm not billing for it. But if I didn't do it, I wouldn't be able to do my job. So I totally relate.
So what is that? Do you think that comes from, so we talked a little bit about this too, like in our DNA, really before millennials, the white collar industry was much smaller. It was a lot more working class, a lot more factory jobs, a lot more farming, a lot more. Before this was really a lot of this stuff that's been automated, there was a lot more blue collar and a lot less white collar. And then the white collar, the executives, the managerial class, if you will, like they didn't have email on them 24/7. They didn't have, you know, multiple devices with multiple streams of communication. And I think that that has probably been, or our anxiety and our stresses and our work culture and all of that has been a product of all of those things.
Yeah. Or even just messages we got, like, I mean, you just shared messages you received about college. I received opposite messages, like you need to go to college. But if we think of work, like, you know, how many of us have heard stories from our grandparents? Oh, back in my day when we walked 5 miles to
uphill work. Uphill both ways.
Yeah, uphill both. But we're hearing those things. Or you think generations before us, like generations, like want their kids to do better and do more. And if that's the messaging with good intent, it also instills this feeling of pressure. Like, oh my gosh, well, I saw, you know, my dad, my grandfather, my mom, whoever raised you, you know, getting up at 5 and going into work and working hard. So that's what I need to do. And I think it's just also societal expectations. I think society puts a lot of pressure on what a work day looks like. And exactly like you said, it's all about the output. I work with a physician who shared with it, this was probably months ago at this point, but she read a research article that talked about how if the healthcare system, like people in the healthcare system only worked 40 hours a week, there would be no healthcare system in the United States. Because there's just expectations to just produce. So I think intergenerational familial messages, I think societal messages, internal pressure of we always need to be doing something.
Right.
Like we preach especially on social media, we preach self-care, but how many of us like feel guilty when we take a break because we're not doing enough? Oh, I could be. And even if it's just, like for me, it's like, oh my gosh, the laundry needs to be done. This needs to be done. This needs to be like, so even if it's not work related, we're thinking of so many other things.
Yeah. You're so right. I didn't even think about, last night I was like, I finished working and I'm like, I got to do the empty the dishwasher. I've got to do laundry. I got to fold laundry. I'm like, this is awful. I just finished and I did all of it and I didn't sit down until 9 p.m. It's crazy.
It is. And I think, you know, other things to consider, I know we talked about like, you know, finances, but like cost of living. So if people are partnered, most household has to have both people dual working income nowadays. If you're not partnered, you're working, but then you're also like trying to pick up extra shifts, extra jobs to just survive. So that's going to be stress. So yeah, if you take time for yourself, it's like, what could I be doing? Because X, Y, and Z still has to be done.
Right.
I think there's so many factors.
So there's, it's basically like there's never peace. There's never.
Like people listening will be like, oh, there's moments of peace. And I'm sure there's people listening that are like, I don't feel that stress, which is wonderful. I'm so happy for those people. But yeah, I agree. Like, I mean, I know you said you listened to my like AMA episode on Welcome to Group Therapy. And like somebody asked a question, like, have you ever been relaxed ever? Which is kind of a running joke. But like, really, if I was thinking about it, I'm like, I don't know the last time. And I think if we asked most millennials, especially like, when's the last time you truly felt like relaxed, calm, at peace for more than like a moment, or like more than like 15 minutes, or even more than a day, if we really wanted to like,
yeah.
And I would argue when we do feel that way, it's usually in unusual circumstances, like, oh, we're on a vacation or things, and we're like disconnected from work or things like that, even though we might be worried.
I was like, I'm curious, like, how, if people actually do ever disconnect from work. I know I was on vacation, and when I'm on vacation, I try really, really hard to disconnect. Mm-hmm. And even if I'm going to check, I like give myself boundaries there. Like, you can check for 5 minutes. If it's something that's a quick response, fine. Otherwise, like, you're not opening a computer, you're not going into any other app on your phone, yeah, to do something. You just got to leave it. But it is a weird, it's a weird thing, because I don't know when I was, I mean, I do know, I was pretty relaxed, like right before filming the show.
Okay.
But I think it was like, there was the down of COVID, and then like, mm-hmm, the up of like, okay. And then I was like kind of hitting a stride and living in it and all that. And that was probably when I was at my most relaxed, but it is difficult to even imagine what that's like.
Yeah. And I think, we going back to this idea of anxiety, we also just don't let ourselves relax, and that relaxation can be uncomfortable and cause us anxiety. I know I've been through that. If I like feel calm, I'm like, okay, what's going on? What am I missing? What's wrong? No, exactly. Because we're just not, we're used to living in like overdrive.
Yeah.
That the idea of just even taking an hour to ourselves to do whatever is calming and relaxing and not letting our mind wander is so foreign to us. Mm-hmm. Like, it's, I can't so even true. Fathom not having my mind wander for that long of time.
You know, it's funny you say that, because that just reminded me, like, my first like breakthrough in therapy was when my therapist asked me to think about whether or not I'm more comfortable in a constant state of anxiety versus a state of calm. Mm-hmm. And noticed, pointed out some patterns, and that was definitely it. And that was when I was like, I've got to be comfortable being calm. And now I spot it with other people a mile away too. Cause it's like, it's once you kind of like understand that sometimes it's more comfortable to be anxious or depressed or whatever that feeling is, that you just don't know how to get yourself comfortable with being comfortable.
Yeah. No, I love that, one, your therapist asked you that, but two, you brought that up, because that's something I talk about a lot with my clients, of whether it's anxiety, depression, those are two I see most frequently. But when they get to a point, like I had a conversation with a client today of how she was able to just like watch a TV show that she really enjoyed and relax while watching it, not like think about all these other things. And we were talking about how like that felt for her, and she was like, it's weird. And that's what I talk to my clients a lot about, like, it is really weird for us, but just because it's weird or uncomfortable doesn't mean it's bad or wrong. It's just different, and we have to lean into that discomfort to make it become a practice. Because if we're uncomfortable with being calm or at peace, we're going to avoid being at calm or being calm or at peace and live in that constant state of anxiety, exactly like you said, because it's more familiar to us. And even if we don't like it, we tend to lean towards familiarity.
Yeah. That's so well said. How can, or how would you recommend people lean into that more?
The calm.
Yeah. Like enjoying the moments when you watch a TV show, and it's, what was I watching last night? I was watching something last night, and I just remember thinking, man, I would really enjoy this a lot more if I had a glass of wine. Like the relaxation, not the show. Like the show was fine. Oh, it was The Patient with Steve Carell. It's on.
Yep.
Have you heard of it or seen?
I've heard of it. I haven't seen it, but yes, I've heard about it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a good show. Highly recommend.
That's what I've heard.
Yeah, I was like watching. I'm like moving around. I'm like, man, if I just had a glass of wine to take the edge off, I didn't. But I was thinking that. So it is like, why couldn't I just sit there at 9 o'clock at night and watch a couple episodes of the show?
Yeah. So I mean, a lot of things are coming to mind. I think one, how often do we actually fully immerse ourselves into one thing in our society now? Like, I know for me, I'll have a movie on, but then I'm checking my phone. I'm like up. Like, I always do laundry with something on the TV. Like, cause I'm like, this will, which is technically a, it can be a therapeutic intervention, like pairing it with something more enjoyable. Yeah. Cause I don't like laundry, but you know, I put on a movie, but then I'm checking my phone. I'm doing this. I'm doing work while watching something. So I think first step is if you're the type of person that's doing a lot of things, pick one activity and really try. And that's going to be uncomfortable at first too. Mm-hmm. Put the phone away, things like that. I think we also just have to be very intentional about, you know, what are things that I know if I was fully present would bring me joy or make me calm. I know you, well, maybe not now in the winter, but enjoy your walks.
Oh, I do. Chicago. I actually,
okay.
I asked my mom for a heated vest and she got it for me. So now I've got very a heated nice. Vest to make them more tolerable.
Yeah. But like, how many times do we go on walks, but we're, I mean, you and I were talking about this before we record, we're listening to podcasts or music, which is not necessarily a bad thing, but you know, when's the last time you or anybody listening went on a walk and just focused on what was in the environment around us, your feet on the pavement, all those kind of things. It's an intentional practice. And it's also pushing through that discomfort of like, mm-hmm. just because, like I said, just because it's uncomfortable doesn't mean it's bad. But I think identifying the things that you're like, okay, if I could be fully present with this thing, it would bring me peace, calm, joy. And start there. Because, you mm-hmm. know, for one person, it might be, if I was completely present going for a walk, I would feel better. For another, it's like, if I was completely present watching my favorite comedy and just was laughing, mm-hmm. like that's what it sounds like to me. Joy sounds like to me.
So true.
Also doing it frequently. Because I think that's the other thing, going back to just this idea of how our mental health is so bad as millennials. When we are stressed, when we are anxious, when we are burnt out, depressed, the first things to go in our life are the things that make us the happiest.
Why is that?
But it's so true. Like, I mean, I'm sure you can think about, I can think about when I'm stressed out at work. Obviously, like obligations, like I'm a parent, so I still take care of my child or things like that. But the things that go are, I don't know, your nighttime journaling or meditation or reading or exercise or whatever, because we conceptualize those as like self-care or extra things rather than necessities. When in reality, if we stop doing the things that make us happy and fulfilled and better people, we're just going to be more stressed and anxious and burnt out because we're not giving ourselves relief from the stress and overwhelm. We're just giving all our energy. Recovery. Oh, exactly. Like, how are you supposed to recover from burnout if you never, if all you're doing is putting your energy into all the things that burn you out?
Gosh, that's so well said. You know, it's funny you say that too, because I'm thinking like, I'm an introvert, which mm-hmm. obviously, you know, like introverts, people don't know how introverts and extroverts work. Like everybody's a percentage, right? Nobody's 100% yeah. one or the other. And it varies, but, and of course you should be probably talking about this, not me, but,
that's
but
fine.
You know, learning I was introverted was a huge thing for me to help overcome, you know, really some of my depressive mm-hmm. feelings, because I thought there was something wrong with me, that I didn't always want to socialize, that I enjoyed spending time playing as a kid by myself or writing by myself, going on walks by myself. And it took me a long time to kind of like, you know, figure out, oh, that's what's going on. But like, introverts are not creeps that don't know how to socialize, like a lot of people tend to think. It's the way you recharge. So a lot of people yep. who are introverted, they recharge by spending time by themselves. So that's walking, reading, exercising, watching a show, something in between. And then extroverts recharge by being
social.
being social, whether that's on the, like I hear people and I know people, and this is totally fine, but it's like crazy to me, which that's a me thing. Mm-hmm. But people who work and then they go and they like talk on the phone or they FaceTime for like 3 hours. That is my worst nightmare. Like, I'm like, don't call me after work unless we have scheduled this ahead of time. Yep. And I understand what you want to talk about. And I wouldn't expect me to be on the phone for 3 hours.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
so
yeah,
the recharge.
I totally get that. Yeah. I'm introverted as well. And you obviously know Justin, Dr. Justin Puder. Even though we're co-hosts on a podcast, like, he is so extroverted and I'm so introverted. So like, when we were together, we get along great.
I thought you were going to tell me he was introvert, and I was like, no freaking
no.
way. Just from his content.
But it's just so fun because, like, when we were together, I was like, how are we even friends? Like, we're so different. But yeah, no,
I'll be sure to send him that clip.
He knows it. We say it all the time. But no, exactly. It's that recharging. So, like, going on. You know, I gave very introverted examples because I'm also an introvert. But for extroverts, you know, if you're stressed out, burned out, having anxiety, you might be canceling plans with friends because you're like, I don't have time for this. But if that's what recharges you, if that's what brings you joy and happiness, why are we eliminating? But we all do it. But I think it's because, like I said, we think of those as like extra things or like, I don't deserve to, you know, spend time doing this when I have so many other things on my plate. But then you're always going to have those other things on your plate.
Right. And it's easy to say too, like, I know I promote self-care all the time, but you're right. Like, I didn't even think about it until you said it, but I let it go first. And so it's very, even today, right before we were recording, I took my dog for a walk and I took him over to the dog park and there was no other dogs there. So he's running around. He's got a stick. He wants to play. And I'm sitting there like on my phone and I'm just like, this is so stupid. Like, he sits here all day while I don't really pay that much attention to him. And now I'm like out here and I love playing with my dog. But instead I was like checking emails and checking social and, you know, reading on what happened today that I didn't see. And it's like being present with my dog who's trying to get my attention and I'm not giving it to him and that recharges me, but I was not letting it, you know, it's very clear if you step back sometimes, even if you know you're supposed to be doing. Self-care.
Oh, absolutely. Well, and that brings me back to another point that you brought up earlier. Like, do we ever really disconnect? And that goes into not only just work, but like social media, which I know you wanted us to touch on in our conversation as well. Like, we are so connected all the time to everyone. And I mean, I am going to be the first to say, I love social media. It has connected me with so many wonderful people. If it wasn't for social media, you and I wouldn't have met everybody. I do my group therapy podcast and I wouldn't have met like all of these things, but we are constantly connected to people. We are constantly comparing ourselves and our lives to people. Even if we tell ourselves it's a highlight reel, people only put things on, we're constantly, exactly, what news did I miss today? It used to be, I remember growing up, you put on the news like, what, 7 a.m. and like 6 p.m. or whatever it was. Yep. Like,
everybody had their favorite channel.
That's when you got your news. We're so inundated with so much information all the time. No wonder we're anxious, overwhelmed, stressed. Like, FOMO is real, the fear of missing out. Like, how many times have any of us put our phone down, gone to do something, and then picked it up without thinking to check, what did I miss in the last 10 minutes? Yep. Did so-and-so post that thing yet? Or like, and news spreads so fast and you feel like you miss out if you're off social media for 24 hours.
Which I can tell you, I was off of it for about 5 days just last week. And I had to, so I have my notifications turned off. I turned them off about a little over a year ago. And that's a life changer. And
pro tip for your mental health. Good job.
shut them off. It doesn't matter. Nothing is happening on social media that is going to immediately change your life if you miss it or if you catch it. Nothing. Yeah. There's just nothing on there that you're not going to get if it's an emergency from some other form of contact. But turning that off and putting social media on my time was a great thing. And it's been, I can't believe it. I've done it for a year. And then what I noticed it did is it created a sense of anxiety when I would go back in and it would be like, 25, 30 DMs. And I'm the pressure to answer these and the pressure to respond. And like, God forbid you look at it and then you leave it on read. And it's like, now it's this whole different stressor. And then that isn't just on social. That's like on your text messages and your phone calls. And like, you own your time, but it's not always easy to feel comfortable owning your time.
Yeah. Well, and then a lot of times we feel like we have to apologize or give an explanation for why we didn't respond so quickly. But you think about, like, you know, growing up in the 90s for both of us, we had a landline. And if somebody called and you weren't home, you left a message and they got back to you when they got back to you.
When they felt like it.
Yeah, if they got back to you. But now we're just all, and we all have our phones on us. We're all so connected. You know, if you're talking to somebody via text and then they don't respond, even though they just responded, then you're like, why aren't they responding? Are they mad at me? Did something happen? Like, social media and the connectedness, although it can be so great, it breeds anxiety in many ways, unless you set clear boundaries around your usage. So I love what you said about turning off notification, owning your time. Like, that's something I've had to work on. You know, I don't have to respond to people if I don't want to, like, whether it be social media, whether it be text message, whether it be a phone call, like I don't. And if I always say, especially someone calls me, going back to the introvert thing, like, don't call me. Like, I literally talk to my parents and my sister on the phone. And that's about it.
Yeah.
But like, if it's important enough, you're going to leave me a voicemail. Or you will
send a text
saying like, hey, I really need to talk. But I think a lot of us, even though I know you said you preach self-care, a lot of us preach self-care, boundaries, all these things. Mm-hmm. But then actually implementing those things is a lot more challenging than just saying, let's do this.
Well, and even implementing them, it's like, that's all encompassing, but you can set them, but if you don't enforce them and you don't give consequences, and I think that's where it's hard for people. And me too. I consider myself an expert at boundaries now, because I've realized how much peace I get when I do them. And I'll boundary anybody I want anytime. But it is sometimes like, there's still guilt that comes with it. And there's, you know, that pressure of, you know, people needing support and you wondering like, oh, what is this going to do our relationship? Or if they're, you know, struggling or breakup or family issues or work struggles, like, it does, it creates a pressure, but, you know, everybody's also kind of responsible for their own wellness, and you can't put that on somebody else, right? It's not fair to do that to either of you.
No, absolutely. And you know, a lot of times when we think about boundaries, we think about boundaries with other people, which is so important. But thinking also about this, like all the things we've already touched on, this global idea of millennials being anxious, like boundaries around work. Like, if you are paid for 40 hours a week, you only have to work 40 hours a week. Like, said it, not taking on that extra project. Boundaries around social media is something I love talking about, because we're so inundated with social media. Mm-hmm. Millennials were the first generation to really grow up on social media. Gen Z has never known life without social media.
Crazy.
I know. So like, yeah, boundaries with notifications, responding to DMs. Like, I can't even imagine how many DMs you get, but like, that's something I had to, you know, really learn when I started growing my social media presence, especially as a psychologist. People will reach out in crises and you're like, oh my gosh, I want to, like, but you
can't.
Ethically, you can't, but emotionally. So like, if it comes to my message requests, like, I usually don't even read them. There was a time, I think it was in November, I cleaned out my entire message requests on Instagram. Mm. Didn't read a single one. Part of me felt bad, but I was also like, this was so liberating.
Yeah.
Like, now I don't know. Now I'm not like going back.
There's no guilt of what did I miss? And that's the thing.
There was at first, but then I was like, but now I never know. I can't go back.
Yeah.
And it's my social media and my boundaries. And I know that it was a time that I was getting a lot of messages that I could tell was like really negatively impacting my mental health. But boundaries around like who you follow on social media, how you spend your time, and learning how to set boundaries is going to help your mental health, reduce anxiety once you get over that initial guilt, because it is hard.
There's the initial like spike in anxiety before it comes back down.
But you know, like you said, the more you do it, the peace you find. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, no. That's fine. I was just going to say, I think the greatest unspoken feature of social media is the mute and restrict. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep. Those two features, you have them on your social media. If there's an account that triggers you, if there's an account that upsets you, if there's an account that you don't want to see, and it could be family, it could be friends. We all have family and friends that are super annoying on social media. Mute them. You don't have to see their stories. You don't have to see their posts. You don't have to see their reels. You don't have to see their TikToks. Mute them. Restrict them if you have to, so that you don't even have to see the DMs, right? You can do that, and then you're not creating drama by unfollowing someone, and then you're still protecting, you know, a friendship that's maybe totally fine without social media, or a family relationship that's totally fine without social media. But then you're also protecting yourself from getting frustrated with your, you know, your friend's super happy life, or your family member airing out dirty laundry. And it can be just, it can kind of like, not facilitate, but almost filter your social media experience. And I had, after the show came out, and then subsequently all the drama that in my life that unfolded, I went and I had to pretty much mute every single person that I knew or was connected with that was from reality TV. Because every time I saw someone having, you know, a wonderful, I talked about this on not this year, but the year before, I was miserable, and I was not about to see everybody who I know who's an influencer go post these extravagant photos of their wonderful galas and their beautiful $5,000 outfits. And it was very helpful to not have to see that. And
absolutely,
I think that's something people can take into their everyday life. Like, just go mute someone that you don't want to have drama with, but is upsetting or triggering to see.
Yeah.
And unfollow the accounts that piss you off. That's okay too.
Absolutely. And to take that advice a step further, like I tell people all the time too, you know, there's a balance with, you know, the amount of information we get on social media. It can be great, but also it can be overwhelming. So if you are seeing, like, not to get into it, but like we are all well aware, there's a lot of bad stuff going on in the world right now. And if that is so overwhelming and flooding your feeds, like you can set boundaries around that as well. Whether that's like, I'm only going to set time like 30 minutes a day to kind of update me on what's going on in the world. And yes, that is a very privileged statement because we are viewing world issues from
absolutely
afar in social media. But like, it doesn't always just have to be with people. It can be about the information you are consuming. It can be about not responding to comment. I know you've talked about that in different ways on your podcast and other, but like not responding to comments, like turning off comments. There's so many ways that you can set boundaries on social media that's going to impact your mental health positively, while recognizing at first it is hard and it does cause a lot of anxiety, guilt, but you're going to feel so much better.
It's like if you're on a treadmill and like if you hit this extra 30 seconds, you're going to feel like you're going to die for about 35, 40 seconds, but then you're going to feel proud and you're going to experience the benefits a little bit later when things calm down. And that's kind of how it is. Like, you're going to have that. I think you'll have a spike in anxiety from FOMO almost too. And
yeah,
FOMO,
absolutely,
we could probably do a whole nother episode on, but you know, it is that like initial spike of angst, but I believe it will fade and you will kind of find yourself, or at least this was my experience, like reconnecting to things that maybe you would have spent that time mindlessly scrolling.
Yep. Oh yeah. Absolutely.
And I'm going guilty back of mindlessly scrolling too. So.
Oh, I know. Well, I think we all are. But that goes back to what we were talking about earlier. When we're stressed, overwhelmed, we let things go. Social media like drags us in. We're mindlessly scrolling. It's been an hour. What would I have rather done with that hour? I could have been more productive. If you're like balancing whether that's like putting stuff, or I could have read, or I could have watched my favorite.
Which is productive.
Movie. Yeah, exactly. And it's also like redefining productivity. That's a whole other thing we could talk about because I think our generation thinks of
these topics.
I know. Productivity as like work, but taking time for yourself is productive to recharge. But even if we're thinking about this overall idea of like millennial anxiety and like mental health getting worse, you need to find small ways to make your mental health better. And I personally feel that social media is a good place to start if you're active on it. Setting those boundaries, reducing the time, catching yourself when you're mindlessly scrolling. Because people, I feel, underestimate the power of small changes. I would love if everybody had access to therapy and wanted to go and could go. But the reality is that's not a reality. And there are plenty of things that we can be doing to better our mental health outside of therapy. Boundaries is a huge one. Reducing time on social media, being intentional about the things we enjoy, spending time outside, sleeping, eating a good, balanced, nourished diet. Like all of those things have such positive impacts on our mental health. Yet once again, everything I listed is probably the first things to go because we're so stressed out and overwhelmed all the time.
So true. And just moving your body too, like you said it, like going on a walk, whatever. Moving your body is such a – I remember like when I first got my Fitbit 10 years ago, I realized I was doing like 4,000 steps a day. Now, under no circumstances am I ever under 10,000, and my goal is set to 15,000. So it's like I force myself to do that because I just know I feel better, and I've learned over time that that's something that helps me. And maybe walking helps you, but maybe it's not, you know, that silver bullet, but find what that is and make sure you always make time for it.
Absolutely. I love that you brought that up because I'm a huge proponent of exercise and tying it back to other reasons that our generation is so like overwhelmed. Like every generation had the diets and stuff, but diet culture definitely exploded with our generation, the comparison. So I think a lot of people, when they think of moving your body, they think of exercise and aesthetics. But like if you hate running, you're not going to run. Like you're going to be miserable doing it. But if you enjoy dance or I don't know, yoga. I try to do yoga. I feel better after, but during it, I'm like, I'm in so much pain. But even
I love yoga. I used to do it for hot yoga three, four times a week, and it was a game changer. But let me tell you, like at first it was not a game changer. It was horrible. It was embarrassing. And I would, you know, I sweat a lot, so it was like times a thousand in that hot yoga class. But you do, you know, it was to me, it was like the effort of going at first, like making sure I go. And even now, I was just talking to my friend earlier yesterday about this. And, you know, she's trying to get back into the gym and get consistent with it after a few months of a complicated move and busy work schedule. And, you know, I was telling her, I'm like, you know what? Like, I work out 4 or 5 times a week. There's weeks where one of those is a good workout and the other one's just keeping the habit. So there's things to that too. So I know, we've been talking for a while now. Oh my gosh, longer than I thought. last thing I want to ask you, and then I'll turn it over to you. So you gave some great advice, social media boundaries, work boundaries, making sure that you're doing things for you, the self-care element, that's super important. If you had to give people that tiny little thing, where to start, you had to pick one, because, you know, I agree, little changes lead to big changes. And you had one piece of advice to someone who's looking like, where do I start to just help with my anxiety? Like, what's an easy baby step?
Oh, Okay. I mean, this is a great question. It always gets me because as a psychologist, I'm like, there's never one step.
I know.
There's always.
You give three. We've got different people that'll do different things.
Yeah. Well, and I can go on. Like, anxiety is not one size fits all, things like that. I'm a big fan of the first step for anything is taking inventory of your life. So with anxiety, what are the areas of my life that I am feeling the most anxious, most overwhelmed? You can write this down. And then of those things, which one do I want to tackle first? Like going back to baby steps. So if I'm like, you know, after listening to this, I realize like social media makes me so anxious. I'm also anxious about finances and work and stuff, but social media seems to be more in my control. Okay, let me start there, whether that's a boundary setting or whatever it is. So I think first, really, the first step, which is so broad in general, we don't really know how we're feeling, because that's another thing, we don't like to sit in our feelings until we take pause and take inventory. Like, what is actually going on in my life? Like, where am I stressed? What would I like to be different, better, things like that? And after you are able to truly reflect and identify, start with the easiest thing. Like, it doesn't have to be the thing that makes the biggest impact, because maybe, you know, your job is really overwhelming and burning you out. And right now, you don't have the financial flexibility to get up and quit. So that's going to be longer. So I think take inventory and then start with one area and just focus on that area. So I think that was one answer, but really long.
No, it was. But you know, you got to break these things into bite sizes, right? If you look at like, well, I don't like my job, I want a new career. Good luck with that. Like, that's a good vision. But then like, what's step one to that? And how do you, you know, how do you do that? Well, maybe it's you free up some time for yourself to like take some quizzes, do some journaling, figure out, you know, what do I like about my job? What do I not like about my job? That's how I figured out I liked marketing was it was like, what do I like about filmmaking? It's the storytelling, you know? So I think it can help. I think that's really good advice. I think it's baby steps, right?
Oh, absolutely. And like, and everybody is going to be different. And that's why it's so hard to give like a one step. But I think all of us can take inventory of our life and what it looks like, where we're feeling most stressed, anxious, burnt out, and what is one small change that could do that? Or even if it's just like, you know, I don't even know where to start, but I'm going to be intentional about setting aside 15 minutes a day to do something just for me. And that probably is going to help you get clarity on where to start, right?
I love that.
So,
and I encourage everyone to start your day off by making your bed. I feel accomplished immediately because I make my bed. It's so weird.
No. And I love that. I know that we're running out of time, but I love that you brought that up, because that last tangent, I think people underestimate the things like making our bed. Oh, I brushed my teeth. I showered. Like, those are not only going to make you feel a lot better, but those are wins, because we're in such a society of like bigger, better, like grandiosity. And it's like, today I put up my laundry the same day I washed it. That never happens in my household. But like, that's a win. Yeah. Make your bed. Make sure you're getting nourishment in your body. Brush your teeth. Like, those things are going to make – wash your face. I feel so much better after my face is washed.
Oh my gosh, me too.
Like,
me too.
So yeah, making sure you're doing all this basic self-care. Okay, so I ended up with more than one tip. Now that we talked about
it. These are good. They kind of go together. It's like, start small, right?
Yeah.
And that can be making your bed every morning, brushing your teeth, and washing your face.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Let me hand it over to you. I can't wait for this question because you told me you've thought of it already. So
yes.
What do you want to ask me? So you froze up there and I got, you can speak of, and then from millennials. So could you ask it one more time?
Yeah, I'll mark this. So you can speak of your perspective either being on reality TV, but I think really I want just your perspective in general. How do you think reality TV has impacted anxiety in millennials? Because we were also the first generation to really watch reality TV. Or do you think it hasn't impacted our mental health at all.
I mean, this could be a whole nother, we could probably start a whole podcast about this. So I think about this a lot. And one of the big reasons I think about it is because, and I've said this before in different contexts, but I had done a lot of work on my mental health, my wellness, my health in general. And I had really eliminated a lot of unnecessary drama or a lot of negativity out of my life. And that's from friends, family, all that. But opening my life up to basically the whole world really showed me kind of how damaged and hurting and struggling so many people are that didn't have access to the tools or didn't have the wherewithal to be self-aware or whatever that is. And so what I think reality TV has done is it has taken a lot of trauma and it has given people an outlet to project these traumas on people they see on TV under the guise of it being real life.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, and I've spoken to 100 plus reality cast members from across the world, from different types of shows. And very rarely, I'm going to say very rarely because there's people I haven't talked to, but everyone I've talked to is like, it's not real.
Yeah.
These are manufactured situations that are outside of the norm. And it's presented to you like it's a documentary. Mm-hmm. And it's just not. And by the way, documentaries have their own problems, as I've recently found out, you know, working with the people of a documentary called Subject, which is focused on how documentary filmmaking impacts people's lives. And it's a lot of the same issues that we found with reality TV. But I think it's giving people, and the internet plays a part, right? It's giving people this ability to project their trauma, their insecurities, their jealousy. And I'm not afraid to say it, like people are jealous because they think they could have handled it better, or they would have done better, or they make a really good reality TV. And like, they just don't know. So it's just these projections, these insecurities being spewed all over the internet and in real life, and the jealousy and the envy and all these things together, I think are just, and it gives people an outlet because they watch it and they think it's real. And that one of the things that Dr. Isabel Morley from the UCAN Foundation, who's also a clinical psychologist, says is that these shows are normalizing abuse. They're normalizing these bad behaviors. And even if they're not as bad as they might look on TV, or they might be worse than they look on TV, because it's edited and your mind is like programmed to believe in what you see, that you may even know this is an edited, not real show. Yep. But still, there's this piece of you that like, I saw this, these are real people. It's not a scripted movie. And it's like this weird thing. So I think the impact it's had is, I think it's crazily impacting the cast members. And then absolutely. I think it's giving an outlet to people who are viewers, and not everybody, of course, but like an outlet to project trauma and insecurities and jealousy and envy and hate and inner ugliness onto other people that they would probably never do in real life. There's always going to be someone that will, but there's very rarely these people that are being mean on the internet, or like, I don't go on Reddit, but holy cow, when people send me stuff that's on Reddit, I'm like, who are these people?
Yeah.
And why don't they have anything better to do?
Yeah.
So I think that's the thing, is it's obviously impacting the participants and the cast members, but I just think it gives this weird outlet to the viewers to just project all sorts of stuff.
Yeah. No, thank you. I knew what you were going to say from the cast member side, but like, especially, you know, with all your work with the UCAN Foundation and just like being on it and just thinking of our conversation with, you know, our generation, like, I think what was the real world is always what I think of as like one of the first like reality
the OG
TV shows and things like that. And Or even just like, I remember watching a lot. I don't watch reality TV really anymore, but even being like in college and like, I cringe when I reflect on me saying this, but I remember saying like, I watch reality TV to like make me feel better about myself. But in reality, I didn't feel better because then, like you said, you start hating people for no, like, I don't know these people, but the way they're like portrayed on social media or just, I mean,
in an edit.
There's obviously, and comparison, all those things. But I appreciate you answering that because I feel like that definitely, I don't know, that's something we didn't even touch on, how like TV and the whole media outside of social media has impacted our mental health. All. I know.
I think exactly. We should just start a podcast with things that, because I'm like, yeah, I could talk about that too. But yeah, I just think it's really unfortunate. And then what I find crazy is that, like, I know for a fact that these shows have people on Reddit and they have paid commentators and stuff that they're hitting talking points. They're stirring up drama online to make things worse than they even have to be. So it's just an unfortunate state of affairs.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Because like we were talking about, movies, TV can be like a positive escape in mental health, but I feel like reality, and some people might argue like, oh, it makes me feel better, but we get so invested in these people. And like, and that can't be good for us.
No, I agree. It puts like the reflection, it's almost like the good or the bad, right? Like you see a love story, and I got to see both things.
Yeah.
For good or better or worse, like people that were just so invested in my love story, they didn't care about anything else. And then people who hate me so much for one thing or another. And it's just like, why are there such extremes? Like it's for entertainment purposes. Just sit back and watch it and don't, you know, think you're doing anything other than watching a edited program for entertainment.
Yeah. Yeah.
So that's a good question. That was a good question. You didn't disappoint. You were worried.
I know. Before we hit record, I was like, I'm hyping this up, but I was trying to like connect it to, I knew what we were going to talk about. So,
yeah. So, well, I want to thank you again for coming on today. And I appreciate you sharing your knowledge, but also just being open and honest about your own experiences, because that's sometimes not easy to do, as you know. Yeah. So thanks for coming on, and we'll have to do it again sometime.
Absolutely. Thank you for having me. And yeah, we have 14 other episodes already.
I know, right?
Based like off basically of our discussion. So it was great. So, thank you, Nick.
Yeah. Tell people where they can find you online.
Absolutely. So Instagram is probably where I am most active, or TikTok, but it's the same handle, at Jessica Lee, PhD. Lee is L-E-I-G-H. But if you go to my Instagram or TikTok, we'll have all the links in my bio. And then like you said, Nick, at the beginning, I host two podcasts. So Psych Talk is my solo podcast, and Welcome to Group Therapy is one I co-host, and you can find that on Spotify, Apple, pretty much anywhere you get podcasts.
That's great. And also, if you want to follow, you can just click the links down in the description, because they'll all be there.
Awesome.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us on this week's episode of Eyes Wide Open. If you enjoy the show, the best way to support us is by sharing or dropping a review. For more information and content, check out engagewithnick.com or find me on Instagram at nthompson513. Don't go through life blind. Do the work so you can show up in the world with your eyes wide open.